Hello everyone,
my name is Aleš Lesser. I'm here today to talk to you about the more uncommon uses and abuses of Composer. I wanted to quickly check with you. Please raise your hand. Who of you is using or has used Composer for their PHP projects? As you can see, Composer is pretty popular in PHP space. It is the de facto standard to manage PHP projects, and it offers quite a few nice advantages when you do so. So it is the package manager for PHP, manages your dependencies, but it also generates an autoloader, which you can even optimize in several ways for production. It can fetch packages from all kinds of sources. You can not only fetch them from Packagist, which is the official free repository, but you can use GitHub, you can use zip files, you can symlink from some folder on your hard drive. And together with the PHP framework interop group, it has pretty much changed the entire PHP landscape and forced PHP developers to build their projects in much more modular ways, and thus greatly improved the maintainability of most projects and also the code we use. Composer has a very central role in your project. It is basically the cornerstone of the life cycle of the project. So basically, as soon as you clone a project to a local machine to start development, a simple Composer install sets you up with everything you need. It provides separate production and development paths, meaning that on your local machine, you want to have both the production dependencies and the development dependencies, but you can then just skip to the development dependencies when you deploy to production. You can completely make your project self-contained. This means that whatever tools you need for your development, for testing, for example, you can hook them up with Composer in such a way that every project can have its own versions of these tools, instead of installing them globally and always having to deal with version conflicts and all other kinds of trouble you can get yourself into. So it's basically a Git clone and a Composer install, and you're all set. You can start development. Composer is very extensible, and it provides two main mechanisms for this extensibility. There's the scripts, and there's Composer plugins. And at first sight, these overlap in multiple areas, share a lot of common features, but they have a fundamental distinction in that the scripts only work for your root project. This means that whatever you put into your scripts, if your project is pulled in as a dependency by some other project, the scripts won't run. However, with Composer plugins, this limitation is not included. So you can use Composer plugins inside of a library that is meant to be used as a dependency, as development dependency maybe. And you can then have these plugins be active whenever that library is being used. This means that you can add whatever functionality you want in such a way that a simple Composer require activates that functionality. Here's an example of how you can work with Composer scripts. You can see that we have created a new test command, which first clears the cache by using an additional command and then runs PHP unit. We've also used a hook to make sure that the cache is also cleared every time we run Composer update. This is the basic mechanism of how you can automate your project and build custom project management commands. like this test command, because a simple composer test will then run, will then clear your cache and run your unit tests. This is how you build a plugin. So the first distinction is that the plugin is being defined as a package, and this package is of type composer plugin. This is important. Composer knows can deal with several types of packages. The standard type definition is library, so if you don't provide any specific type mention, it is always a library. And here in this case, we defined it as a composer plugin, and we also require the plugin API. This means that we pull in the PHP interfaces that we need to properly link to the code that composer makes available. Then we, of course, define an autoloader because we want to use classes in our case. Using an autoloader is the obvious choice then. And we then tell Composer what class to use that provides the entry point for the plugin. And on the right side, you see an example implementation of such a plugin. This is this class that we provided in the extra key. It implements the plugin interface, but also the event subscriber interface. And we tell Composer which events to listen to and which methods to call when it triggers these events. There's no code now attached to our method, but you can imagine that whatever you can do in PHP can be done in such a plugin. This plugin system is what opens up Composer to much, much more than only dependency management, because you can basically create whatever your creativity can imagine. So the first example, first use case that I want to present is patching. You've probably already had trouble with some dependency you were pulling in and suddenly noticed that it contains a bug. No problem. Mostly we deal with open source projects, so you can just provide a pull request to fix that bug. But that doesn't mean that the pull request is automatically merged. So in the meantime, you have your fork, which you use to create a pull request, and you can use Composer to pull in that fork instead of the normal canonical library that you would use. The problem with this approach is that you need to keep your fork up to date for as long as the actual fix was not merged, which might take from 1 hour to 10 years or more. What's more, you need to let Composer know that that random other project that you're pulling in that is actually meant to meet the requirement that the other libraries have, so you will create a branch alias. This means that you basically tell Composer this code XYZ that I pulled in, it is meant to actually be this and this project, it just happens to have another name at this moment. But this mechanism is kind of a hack, the way it's implemented in Composer, and it's not really a clean, elegant solution. It cannot be for technical and security reasons, and that's why you will hit all sorts of problems down the road with that approach. Patching is an alternative. It is not necessarily a better alternative. It's just one other possible way of dealing with such a scenario. It basically means that you create a diff of the change you need and let Composer apply it automatically every time you pull in that dependency. This means that instead of needing to sync your upstream changes all the time, your upstream changes will automatically be up to date every time you run Composer update. You don't need this mess with the branch alias because you're still using the official package, you just happen to change it after the fact. As long as the patch applies cleanly, there's no other work involved, it just works, and it will error as soon as the patch does not apply cleanly anymore. And in this way, just tell you that there's some work needed here. You need to pay attention to this. And in the composer.json file, you can even provide some sort of documentation with this patch that you're applying to let yourself and your other team members know what you're actually doing there, what you were trying to fix. Quick tip to get a diff from some random change when you're using GitHub, just go to the URL of the commit and append .diff to that URL, and you will get a clean diff file that you can apply. You can fetch that with wp-get or whatever else you want. So here's an example of dispatching will work. Basically, we added the composer patches package and then let it know what package to patch and with what file to patch it. And as soon as we run composer install, you will see at the bottom that it applies the patch, lets us know what it does, and in that way, our package was modified with the fix we needed without any further work. Every time we now run composer update, it fetches the latest version of our Drupal package in this case, and again applies this patch. So that's an alternative way of going about using libraries that you still need to make changes. Another use case, namespace prefixing. As you might have noticed on the first slide, I work a lot with WordPress, which has its own set of troubles to deal with. One of them is that Composer is not part of the project. So a Composer generally is not used at the root level of a Composer site. WordPress has an extensibility mechanism, which is plugins, which are basically just random PHP files that are being run. But you can use Composer inside of these plugins, of course. If you have a more complex plugin, it just makes sense to use whatever means you can to make it as maintainable as possible. The problem with these plugins then is that as Composer is only run at the plugin level, it cannot deal with conflicts that happen across multiple plugins, because it is only able to see that one version from that one plugin you're actually currently running it. In such systems, it might make sense to modify external dependencies you pull in into your plugin to make sure that libraries that could be used by other plugins will not cause conflicts. One often used library is, for example, Guzzle or Pimple. These are very useful libraries that are often used by WordPress plugins, but if they're just being pulled in as is, plugin A might use version 3 of Guzzle and plugin B might use version 5. And you will get one of the two, depending on the order of how the plugins were loaded, and they are being loaded alphabetically. So it's really just, it's pure chance whether you get your version or the other plugins version. So for prefixing, there's a package that is being used in WordPress space right now. It's called Mozart by Cohen Jacobs. And it basically allows you to define a prefix to apply to all the classes and namespaces of a given package. And in this case, we're using Pimple, pulling Pimple in, and then running the Mozart compose command. And this will then create inside of the normal source folder a copy of that package. And that copy will have all of the same files, but all the namespaces and class references have been prefixed. In this way, when another plugin uses Pimple as well in a different version, it will not cause a conflict. Another use case, keeping external data up to date. Sometimes you have external data like a list of country names or GeoIP information where you need to map an IP address to a given country or code or whatever. And this data is basically a dependency of the project. But if you normally just copy-paste it into the project, you will need to keep it up to date manually. If you use the data in such a way that you can treat it as a managed dependency, like all the other code you use, then it can be version controlled. You can completely control when it's being updated, when it stays the same. You get proper errors when there's a problem with updating the data and so forth. I have a link to an example project here, which is basically a class mapping the MaxMind free GeoIP library. So what this does is it is a Composer plugin that will first check whether there's a change to the data between the remote version and the local version, and if there was a change, it will download the latest version. And as it's a Composer plugin, this just works after every Composer install or every Composer update. This means that you can, for example, run your deployment system, the CD system, continuous deployment system, for example, and this system will every time check whether the data needs to be updated, fetch the latest version, and if there's an error, for example, if there's a problem with the download, your deployment system will throw a proper error because it hit an error condition, like with any other step it takes in its deployment process. So here you can see the example. It pulls in the package that updates the database. It also pulls in a package to read from that database. And I've used the PsyShell, which is a debugging shell you can use for PHP to actually test whether it all works as expected. I just loaded the vendor autoload file from Composer to make sure that the classes are active. And you can see with the IP address I entered in there that I got Poland as the country result. So the IP address happened to be the one I had in my room. So the result looks okay. Commit hooks. When you want to enforce consistent application of rules of how to deal with code changes, how to deal with commit messages, etc., you often face the problem that no matter how many rules you define, if the developers are too lazy to actually run the tools that will check for these rules, you nevertheless get the wrong commits and useless commit messages, etc. So when I tried to build commit hooks for myself, I thought there must be a way to use this with Composer as well. Composer is the one command I need to run to work on my project. I need this Composer installed so that the classes are available to my autoloader. There must be a way to hook up the commit hooks to the Composer flow. So I created a project that basically lets you build commit hooks in PHP classes, and then you can define the commit hooks in your composer.json file. And as soon as you pull in one of these commit hooks as a development dependency, it becomes active as soon as you hit Composer install. So I can show you an example how this looks. This is how you define a new hook in that library. It's basically, this is the main package that defines the interfaces. And here we have, we define a pre-commit hook with a priority of 20 and tell the plugin where to find the method to call. And then we can define our commit hook, whatever logic we need. We can define it in clean PHP code in a proper class. The advantage of this is that one advantage is, as a PHP developer, it's probably easier to get reliable functionality when you're dealing with PHP code instead of bash scripts. Also, as we're pulling in the base action, this already comes with some helper functionality, like getting the state changes or getting the commit message, etc. And what's more, it includes priorities. This means that we can even have multiple hooks on the same event. So for example, for the pre-commit, we can have 30 methods that run one after the other based on priority. So here's again an example of how this will look. You can see I created a fresh Git repository. Then I create some random PHP file, which is badly formatted. And when I now add this, when I want to commit this PHP file now, this will just work because there's no check in place. After this, I pull in such a commit hook through this PHP Composer library, which is basically the PSR2 run through PHP CS. You can see I just do Composer require dev. And now I create a second file that's also badly formatted. And when I now try to commit this file, it will fail because the Composer plugin is active as we had run the Composer install command. We'll see that it will throw the normal PHP CS error as we would expect, and all just works. This means that you can provide the rules that you want to enforce with your projects, and your developers in your team need to actively deactivate them to get around them. By default, everything is just active, which is a huge benefit. Another example, automating boilerplate code. You probably, when you're dealing with Composer, normally the goal is to split up everything into reusable packages, make everything modular, which is a good thing. The problem is that this always takes time to set up these separate packages. It turns out that Composer comes with a mechanism that can be used for scaffolding. It's the create project command. And basically what it does is, if you run Composer create project and some package, instead of pulling in that package to work on it with the source code ready to be changed, it will create a new folder, check out your project into that folder, and it's meant to use that project and that package as a new version that you will commit later to a separate repository. And as it happens to be that Composer also runs all its scripts and all its plugins the same way as it does with all the other commands, you can hook into these. There's an event that is called post create project command. You can hook into that and attach any logic you want. For example, replacing placeholders in whatever it happened to pull down and replacing these placeholders with actual values. For my own needs, I created such a package, which you can see at the bottom. It's called Boilerplate. I'm very creative with naming that way. And it basically sets me up with a very basic package where my README file is properly set up, where I have my unit tests prepared, where I have the autoloader being active, and so forth. So as soon as I hit this create project command, the plugin gets active and asks me a few questions. This can, of course, be adapted for everyone. In my case, the defaults make sense for my particular use. Most of the time, I just run through this with enter, but I can, of course, provide custom data. And as soon as I have filled everything out, it runs. It replaces the placeholders, it It creates additional files. It runs PHP unit at the end to make sure that I didn't create anything that is not that is broken. And so with one single command, I'm completely set up with a new package that is basically ready to commit for the first initial version. Well, you need to add code again still. The last use case I want to present is embedding Composer into other software. Composer, like most PHP projects nowadays, is a set of classes and interfaces, and so it happens to be possible to just run Composer from PHP code, not only from the shell. And most of it is even set up specifically in such a way that it can be easily extended and reused in different projects. So this provides access to all the sources that Composer supports. As I said in the beginning, you can have GitHub repositories, zip files, local files, whatever you can dream up. It contains all of Composer's built-in event dispatching, so all the events that we've seen previously are still active. And the entire scripting and plugin system is usable, even though you're not using Composer directly, but some other software that happens to use Composer within its implementation. One example project that uses it is WPCLI, which is a command line tool to manage WordPress sites through the command line. And it has a built-in package manager, so you can run a WP package install, some name of a package, and that is nothing more than just an embedded version of Composer, which uses a specific type of Composer package and installs everything in a hidden folder in the home, in the user's home folder. So here you can see an example of how this looks. With the WP package list command, you can see what additional packages are installed. Normally, packages are meant to provide additional custom commands, but you can also install whatever else might make sense. With WP package install, we're installing a new additional custom command. When we now hit WP package list, we can see that it was properly installed. It is usable, so this is the help screen of that command, which we freshly installed. And with WP package uninstall, we can again remove the command so that when we hit WP package list again, we see that it's gone again. WPCLI had started using that package manager for custom commands so that people can easily extend WPCLI. After some refactoring of the Bootstrap process, it's now the case that all the bundled commands are also separate Composer packages. And there's a deployment process that builds a FAR file by just running everything through Composer to set up the system with the commands that are meant to be bundled. So it's even dogfooding its own package management system for the built-in internal bundle commands. So I hope that this showed you a quick overview of what is possible with the event system of Composer and the way it can be extended, and that it also provide you with some insights into how you can make your projects more self-contained so that everything that is part of the development workflow of your project is just one Composer install away. And I can't wait to see what you're coming up with. Thank you. Are there any questions? Yeah, too much at once. Okay, then I did my job well, I assume. Ah, yeah. I repeat the question, what are the security implications of this? Yes, first of all, the example I gave with the forking of Composer, where there are some limitations of how you can deal with pulling in a separate package instead of the real package. These limitations are due to security problems that can arise if you can just define a different package to be used instead of the real package, because it might mean that you use a specific dependency and that dependency could override your other dependencies. So Composer already does a great job of prohibiting the ways that could have security implications when you're dealing with automating all of your dependencies. Of course, when you're now working with plugins, when the plugin is active, the plugin is basically PHP running the command line as your current user and can do whatever your current user can. So in this way, a plugin can, of course, be harmful. The issue, though, is that when you're running a Composer install over a package, that package could already have in its scripts a command to delete all your folders or whatever. So the root package can already contain malicious code. So you need to check that either way when you're running Composer install. And the Composer plugins, they will generally be active only because you pull them in via dependency. You can, of course, have a dependency that will pull in a plugin that you're not aware of, but you can just as well have code that you're pulling in that becomes active as soon as you hit the autoloader of the code. For example, if you have a files require statement, that code becomes active as soon as you include the vendor autoload files. So Composer is not completely safe to use without paying attention at all. It's always executable code, so there are security implications. But where it makes sense, Composer already prohibits the most problematic behavior, and for the rest, it's open source code. So in general, you can always check the sources. Yeah. Thank you for the question. Yes? Yes, I quickly repeat the question because of the microphone. So basically, the pre-commit hook, whether the hooks are automatically removed as well, and how it deals with existing hooks. So right now, the project is still pretty early. Right now, when you have existing hooks, these hooks stay in place, but there's no automated mechanism to put the hook that was defined through PHP in place of that one. So basically, when you already have a pre-commit hook, for example, your hook will not get overwritten, it will not get deleted, but you will manually need to make a change so that both can coexist. I plan to add an automation to replace one with the other and then hook your hook back into the system, but that wasn't implemented yet. And for the removing, it is indeed so that when you use Composer to remove that dependency of that hook, the hook will also be removed and become inactive. So that works automatically. A quick detail, the way this works is that inside of the .git folder where you have your hooks folder, normally you put shell scripts in there with the name of the hook, and in this case, all of the hooks get created as symbolic links to the Bootstrap PHP file of the system. And then the system, for every hook, gets launched, sees what hook was activated, and then dispatches. Thank you for the question. OK, great. Thank you all.